May God be merciful unto us and bless us and show us the light of his countenance and be merciful unto us. Let your way be known upon earth, your saving health among all nations. Oh, let the nations rejoice and be glad, for you shall judge the peoples righteously and govern the nations upon earth. We give you praise, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. To you belongs the abundance of the seas and the wealth of the nations. To you every knee will bow and every tongue confess lordship. We look forward to the glorious day, that day when you, the King of Glory, will return, calling all saints to rise and join you in the New Jerusalem. And until then, we confess, Jesus, how blessed is your name. This morning, we also confess that we continue to fall short of your glory. We have not triumphed in your victory of the cross, but have exalted in our own strength and work. We have talked more than we have prayed, judged more than we have forgiven, insisted more than we have listened, hardened more than we have repented. We have looked at our own needs instead of the needs of others, and we have forgotten who our true enemy is and our true King is. Have mercy on us, O God. Give us a broken and contrite spirit, that you will not deny us, but restore us. And shine your light upon us, even in this very moment, as we now pray the prayer your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our coming day's bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into trial, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Church family, now is that time in our service when we honor the Prince of Peace by passing the peace that he bought with the blood, his blood, on the cross. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Good morning, Park Street Church. It's such a joy to worship with all of you. I want to make a particular welcome to those of you who might be new. We hope that you will find a home here, as many of us have as well. For those of you who are in the sanctuary and also those who are joining us by radio or online. My name is John Liu. It is a privilege, a burden, and a joy to serve you and to serve the church as an elder of this church. I have a few announcements to make. One, again, for newcomers. If you are new, please fill out this Connect card. If you put it in the offertory plate when it comes around during the offertory, what that will do is it will give us the chance to get to know you. We'd love to invite you to one of our welcome lunches that we have once every single month. So please fill it out. Help us get to know you better. Now, I also want to let you know on Thursday, November 16, it's our second annual Boston Flourish Conference, and this is an event, it's a gathering where we're working towards a city where everyone will flourish. Last year, the topics that we explored were education, incarceration. This year, the topics that will be explored are mental health, migrant care, and human trafficking. So you can go out either onto our church website or bostonflourish.com to find out more information. And then finally, it's certainly my unique joy to welcome you to the kickoff Sunday for our 2023 Missions Conference. And please turn your attention to the screen for more.
God is on mission. He has one mission for the world throughout history, and it's centered on his Son, Jesus Christ. And he's invited you and me on his mission together with him and with one another.
I I serve God by being a visual artist and a Bible study leader. Most of the women in the group are women I have met through my work as an artist.
I have been privileged to visit our members who are homebound or in nursing care facilities. They are us in 25 years or 50 years, and they are part of our community. Their heart is here.
The gifts that God's given me, along with the service opportunity through my church and being able to serve on a team with other like-minded believers, has been such a growing experience.
God has really blessed me with being able to lead the New England Conservatory Christian Fellowship. Last spring, 20 classmates and I from NEC were able to bring music to the home ministry. And it was amazing to see how we could bless people just with our music.
Soccer Field is a place where people can come and make new friends, leave behind the worries of the classroom and work.
To me, following God in a city like Boston involves creating those spaces and helping people feel like they belong.
Students find themselves in these schools with different friend groups. We want to encourage them to live out their faith. That could be through their conversation.
So for the past couple of years, I've been a part of Boston University Law School's Lawyers Christian Fellowship. We meet once a week, pray for one another, do a Bible study, and then send each other back out into the law school.
The pantry is not just feeding people's bodies, but it's really feeding people's souls. It's providing for their needs.
I think the reason why I really want to live missional is because I didn't grow up in a Christian family, and I know how good this truth, this gospel is.
Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain.
Well, good morning. Good morning. It's Mission Week. Did you get the message? Okay, good. One mission together. God has one mission for his people, for the world, and it's based on his promise to Abraham that he will bless Abraham and the nation, and he will bless the whole world, his people in his place and his time under his blessing. That's his plan for the world. And he's invited you and me, wherever we are, to be engaged in his mission. It turns the world upside down. It turns us inside out. It touches every aspect of our humanity. And God is inviting us into that. And we're privileged this week to focus on one mission together. I would like you to pull out this from your bulletins this morning. Not to look at it, but just to pull it out so that you know it's there and you can get the QR code with all the details of the conference this week from our website. Please do that. There's so much great stuff there to register, to sign up for many different events. And the other thing I want to flag is the new Park Street calendar. You'll see that at the exits as you leave this morning. Please pick up one of these. It's a great way to pray for our mission work here in Boston and around the world. Very practical. You see the faces, get to know them, and hang it in your kitchen. And remember these men and women, we're all on mission together. Whether they're overseas or whether they're here, we're together. So let me highlight a couple of events for you for this week. First of all, Thursday through Friday, each night, 7 o'clock, you can join us for a Zoom conversation with our missionaries and those who are serving locally in Boston. Topics like Bible translation, how does technology and mission synergize together, how do we reach out to our unhoused neighbors. If you've never taken the first step in some of these areas, it's a great way to just be informed and to ask the Lord, Lord, what's going on? How can I be a part of what you're doing in our very midst in Boston and around the world? Then Friday night, we'd love to invite you to a dinner here, 6 o'clock at the church. It's a Japanese cuisine-themed evening where we're privileged to have our missionaries, Adrian and Becca Tam, who are back from Japan. We welcome them to be with us here with their boys, all the way from Japan. I wish I could say that in Japanese, but I can't. I could try. But it's going to be a wonderful evening of enjoying food and fellowship, and also having a discussion with some leaders about what does it mean to be on a mission in Boston. And we've invited several leaders to join us for a discussion about what some of the gospel implications of our life here in Boston really are, and making an impact and being felt in the city of Boston. So that's this Friday night. And then Saturday, a way for us to roll up our sleeves and to serve the city of Boston. You can sign up on our website or through your regional fellowship, different practical ways of serving some of the needs in the Boston metro area. So many different opportunities for us to show the love of Jesus, to touch men and women's lives here today. So as I say, you can sign up and find out more on our website. Well, a special welcome to all our missionaries here, to the Tams who are here, and Adrian and Becca and their family, also Jim and Andrew Zavara. We'll have the Hannahs will be back next weekend, Bible translators who've been translating the Word of God for many decades. But also I'd like to have a very warm welcome for our guest preacher this morning, Dr. Ruth Padilla de Borst. Welcome, Ruth, to us. I know this is coming back to Boston. You did study in Boston in your PhD, and we're so glad that you can share from your heart to us, from the Word of God. Dr. Padilla de Borst is the professor of world Christianity at Western Theological Seminary in Holland, Michigan. She also leads the Casa Adobe, an intentional Christian community in Costa Rica. And she's the former president of the Latin American Theological Fellowship and continues to serve on its board. She's quite familiar with Boston, so we welcome you and we're so glad you're with us. Have a great week.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. Come, everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and he who has no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk, without money and without price. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Listen diligently to me and eat what is good, and delight yourselves in rich food. Incline your ear and come to me, hear that your soul may live. And I will make with you an everlasting covenant, my steadfast love, my steadfast sure love for David. For thus says the Lord, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose the things that please me and hold fast my covenant, I will give in my house and within my walls a monument and a name, better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord and to be his servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God who gathers the outcasts of Israel declares, I will gather yet others to him besides those already gathered. The word of the Lord.
Let's pray for the children as they go to their classes. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of children. Thank you for the gift of families. Thank you that you are our perfect and heavenly Father, looking down, knowing every hair on our head. We pray for the little ones as they go, that you would bless them, speak to them, embrace them with your love. May they know that they are the apple of your eye. Bless their parents and grandparents and relatives, and bless us as the family of faith, that we may nurture and strengthen faith in the life of all who come here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Our second lesson comes from Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, starting at verse 15. And they came to Jerusalem, and he entered the temple and began to drive out those who sold and those who bought in the temple. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold pigeons. He would not allow anyone to carry anything through the temple. And he was teaching them and saying to them, "Is it not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers?" And the chief priests and the scribes heard it and were seeking a way to destroy him, for they feared him, because all the crowd was astonished at his teaching. And when evening came, they went out of the city. The word of the Lord.
Que los dichos de mi boca y la meditación de mi corazón sean gratos delante de ti, Dios y Padre nuestro. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Buenos días. In typical Latin American fashion, I must begin bringing you greetings. So greetings from Western Theological Seminary in Holland, Michigan, where I teach, and greetings from Casa Adobe, the intentional Christian community to which my husband James and I belong in Costa Rica. I'm sure several of you have been to Costa Rica and enjoyed the sun-bathed beaches and the dramatic volcanoes. Costa Rica receives many tourists every year, but it's also receiving hundreds and thousands of refugees and migrants. So many that local authorities are alarmed and struggling to make space for them all. It does, however, continue opening its doors and seeking welcoming ways forward. Today's scripture readings pose some shocking invitations and point towards the fact that contrary to the ways of our world, and often, sadly, to the church itself, in God's economy, there is space for all. We're going to engage these shocking invitations as a drama in three acts. So join me for act one, an invitation to return home. Deprivation, violence, uncertainty, hopelessness, these are conditions binding millions of people the world round today in Latin America and beyond. In this country, rising tribalism and extreme polarizations are ripping families and even churches apart. Not dissimilar were the conditions the people of Israel were enduring during their long exile in this foreign land of Babylon. However, in the midst of it all, they receive good news. Into that reality comes a soothing invitation from God through the prophet Isaiah in what we know as Isaiah 55. Come, all you who are thirsty, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come, buy wine and milk without money, without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread and your labor on what does not satisfy? listen to me and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare. The promise of abundance includes provision for all their needs and far more. Give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promise to David. God offers the tired, bedraggled people full life. God offers to covenant with them, to restore the relationship that was broken by their unwillingness to live out God's purposes. God is inviting them back into the intimate communion they had lost. God is calling them back home, back to their true identity as humans created in God's image. God is willing to forgive, to embrace, to start afresh. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and God will have mercy on them. Turn to our God, for God will freely pardon. Provision, restoration, forgiveness, all promises of goodness will bring celebration and worship, not only for people, but also for nature itself. You will go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills will burst into song before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. To a people burdened by their condition, these words nourished hope. The day would come when their suffering would end. They would return to their land and their lives would be reconstructed to their previous glory. Creation itself, downtrodden as it was by war and drought, by disregard and irresponsible plunder, would be restored. Worship would burst forth. Now, this is act one of the play. The invitation out of exile and into full life, a new, renewed, worshipful relationship with their creator, back to their creaturely identity. Chapter 56 of Isaiah takes us to Act 2, and this is the more shocking invitation. This chapter is part of a section written once the people of Israel are already back home, back in the land of Canaan. The reconstruction has begun, but the expected prosperity is slow in coming. People are still suffering, and they still stand in need of encouragement, and that is what they expect from the prophet. The first call is not surprising, nothing too new. Maintain justice, do what is right, for my salvation is close at hand, and my righteousness will soon be revealed. Blessed is the one who does this, the person who holds it fast, who keeps the Sabbath without desecrating it, and keeps their hands from doing any evil. After centuries of teaching, those that chose to are aware that their covenant with God demands following the commandments given by Moses. Not doing evil and keeping the Sabbath are unquestionable expressions of right religion. The law and the prophets had taught this for centuries. No huge surprise there, although it clearly was not easy to walk the talk. But nothing in their mindset prepared them for the next calls. Maintaining justice and doing what is right is not about right religious acts, but about right relations. And this pushes far beyond the barriers of comfort. Isaiah continues, "Let no foreigner who is bound to the Lord say, 'The Lord will surely exclude me from his people.' And let no eunuch complain, 'I am only a dry tree.'" Foreigners. Hebrew tradition did acknowledge foreigners as special recipients of God's favor. Their law made provision for their care, ensuring, for example, that fruit and grain were left after reaping so that the poor, of whom the foreigners were the most vulnerable, could feed themselves. Israel's history, you'll remember, prominently included foreign women like Rahab and Ruth. However, foreigners were typically also excluded from worshiping God along with the Jewish people. They were not clean enough. They were other. So were eunuchs. By law, they were not allowed to join in public worship of God. Here, however, in the voice of the prophet, God issues these two shocking invitations. Not now to the usual expected insiders. Instead, God is inviting the outsiders, the ones traditionally excluded from fellowship, into full belonging as part of the worshiping community of believers. And God's promises to them are even more extravagant than to the usual insiders. Regarding eunuchs, suffered men weighed down by shame and rejected, who will never bear children and whose name consequently will be lost, God says, to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths, who choose what pleases me and hold fast to my covenant, to them I will give within my temple and its walls a memorial and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that will endure forever. God addresses these nobodies and welcomes them into intimate communion with God's self. They too can step into God's covenant of life. God promises to grant these people, discarded by society, a name better than sons and daughters. To these people, who by not having descendants could easily be forgotten by future generation, God promises an everlasting name. Against all prejudice and exclusions, God affirms their dignity and intrinsic value. And God's outrageous invitation insists on addressing the other nobodies. Isaiah continues, and foreigners who bind themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath without desecrating it and hold fast to my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and give them joy in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and sacrifices will be accepted at my altar. For my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations. Although Jewish tradition allowed foreigners to become proselytes, that is, to confess the Lord of Israel as the one true God, they would never allow these outsiders to worship God along with them. They were marginalized by those who felt far superior. They were no more than second-class citizens. But God welcomes them and affirms that in God's house and in God's work in the world, there is room for all people who seek the Lord from all the nations. It is precisely this text that Jesus cites centuries later when he cleans out the temple in Jerusalem. The problem on that occasion is not simply that merchants have set up business in the temple and are probably exploiting the poor pilgrims who have traveled to Jerusalem by hiking up prices. What angers Jesus is that they have set up their stalls precisely in the patio of the Gentiles, in the area designed to welcome foreigners into God's presence. By doing so, they are depriving foreigners from access to worship and belonging. Jesus reminds everyone, my house is a house of prayer for all nations. He will not tolerate any attitudes or actions, personal or structural, that hinder access to the full life God intends for all people. Now we move on, in closing, to Act 3. Park Street, you and me and shocking invitations today. Clearly, this last act is ours to perform. In closing, a few questions may help us design the plot. First, might there be a sense in which you, we are living today in some sort of exile, even in the midst of our relative prosperity and security, distanced from our Creator and overly absorbed in life-sapping preoccupations? Are we personally or corporately in need of hearing God's call home? Are you thirsty for God's loving embrace to recover your true identity? The words of the prophet issue a clear invitation. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and God will have mercy on them. Turn to our God, and God will freely pardon. God yearns to welcome each of us home. God yearns to welcome each of us home. But there is more. God also yearns to use our very arms to embrace those who no one else welcomes. This is part of our true vocation as God's people. Now, you better than I know who the eunuchs and the foreigners are in U.S. society today. You, better than I, know what barriers, personal and structural, were built historically and are still being built to exclude them from full belonging and real fellowship in the Christian community and U.S. society in general. You know, or do you? What is the church doing to remedy the centuries of exploitation, exclusion, degradation and violation of most basic human rights suffered by the people who first inhabited these lands, of the people trafficked from Africa and forced into slavery, of the thousands driven from home and land today because of violence or global warming? Do you know, or do you care to know, what injustices must be confessed and what steps must be taken in order that both here and around the world, the marginalized, the least privileged, the outsiders also have access to the full life God intends for all people? I could share with you what I see happening in Central America thanks to U.S. migratory policies and business interests, and how the livelihoods, rights, and health of entire populations are being violated. And I'm sure you could cite to me, on the other hand, the variety of ministries, Park Street spearheads in the greater Boston area and abroad. But even so, necessary questions still remain. Who are the foreigners and eunuchs in Boston that God is calling you to invite in today? In what ways are you challenged to embrace them? What next steps will you take as ambassadors of God's expansive love? The ancient Israelites were called to not dwell on their own limitations and misfortunes, but to receive God's loving embrace and so recover their true identity. And in turn, they were challenged to step into their true vocation and embrace the most vulnerable among them. So may God grant us love, grace, and courage to make shocking invitations today and in the days to come. May we acknowledge in word and deed that there is space for all. And may we walk in justice so that everyone and everything may go out in joy and be led forth in peace. Amen.
Please be seated. Ayo gozaimasu. Good morning, Park Street Church. Rebecca and Adrian Tam, serving with Pioneers in Japan, along with our two boys, Isaiah and Aaron. It's wonderful to be back in Boston to be with you, our church family, during this mission conference. As many of you may know, this past summer, we had the privilege of welcoming Pastor Mark, his son Jameson, and Pastor Julian and his wife Kim. A few weeks later, Ken, Shaw, Jaden, and Izzy came as a short-term team to serve our Japanese church's Vacation Bible School outreach. Thank you for praying and for supporting these all as they brought figurative tokens of your love, as well as literal tokens in the form of suitcases filled with treats. Why are we serving in Japan? It's often assumed that Japan, a democratic G7 nation, has no need of missionaries. Yet consider this, the Japanese are the second largest unreached people group in the world. The evangelical Japanese church accounts for less than 0.5% of the population. The population is shrinking, but the church is shrinking faster, and the average church pastor is over the age of 65. Despite these numbers, it's still easy for Japan to seem distant and non-strategic. But God has not forgotten Japan. He is doing something special, drawing people to himself. Consider Akari, a neonatal pediatrician who, confronted with her inability to save every child she meets, has shed tears during Bible study with me. Or consider Satsuki, a runner who, with a broken past, happened to see the church on one of her evening runs and came in for the prayer meeting and has come to church ever since. Or consider Daisuke, who joined a seeker's Bible study wanting to turn around a broken life that includes a wife and child who refused to talk to him anymore. These are but a snapshot of those God is calling to himself. At the same time, we're seeing an explosion of missionary interest in Japan. God in his mercy is remembering the Japanese people. As for our family's ministry in Japan, we're responsible for training new missionaries after they arrive on the field. Many of you may know that we have been new missionaries twice, first in a closed access country, and then once again when we arrived in Japan. Both times we felt like babies in our new environment, fully dependent on others, emotionally vulnerable, and immature to the customs and expectations of the culture around us. For this reason, we've committed this season of our ministry to equipping new missionaries to be effective in language learning, cultural engagement, spiritual formation, collaboration with others, and church planting work. In addition to the program's curriculum, we also provide practical assistance, mentor new missionaries through their ups and downs, and lead a house church where new missionaries practice doing church in English and Japanese. We get to see missionaries take their first baby steps in interacting with local culture, hear them speak their first words in the Japanese language. Then as they mature, we see them having their first play dates with Japanese friends, sharing bits and pieces of their testimony of God's work in their lives. Finally, when they're ready to spread their wings, we release them to the work of church planting, a work that can take years or even decades. Let us tell you about the Ho family, who moved last year from New York City with their four young children. Simon, the father, was setting up for the worship service in front of his church one Sunday when he saw an elderly man coming by in his wheelchair. Even though Simon had barely begun his language studies, he was able to offer a simple invitation to the man to come into the church. As you may know, men are a rare breed in the Japanese church, and yet within weeks of that invitation, this man accepted Christ as his personal Savior and Lord. Simon came away encouraged that God would use even his imperfect Japanese invitation as one part of his good plan for the Japanese people.
We want to share another story about how God uses each of our efforts, no matter how limited we might feel. Back during the pandemic, our family had gotten to know a couple neighboring families, occasionally exchanging gifts and brief conversations in the hallway, though always behind masks. We desired a deeper connection, but the pandemic ensured our relationship always remained at arm's length. So all we felt we could do was pray, and then as time passed, we moved to a larger home in order to better host new missionaries. When the Ho family arrived in Japan with their four children, the only available apartment in our area willing to rent out to foreigners happened to be our old apartment. It wasn't ideal. It was on the small side, and the downstairs neighbor was especially sensitive to noise. After receiving several complaints from that downstairs neighbor, the mother, whose name is Song, began to look into other apartment options. However, due to discrimination against foreigners, nobody was willing to rent to them. Song began to despair, but as we walked with her through this journey, we all realized God had something else in mind. The very neighbors that we had been praying for back when we had lived in that same apartment, those neighbors' daughters began to connect with Song's oldest daughter. After some time, the girls began walking home from school together and hanging out in each other's homes. Not long after that, the parents began to also come over for long conversations, leading into dinner on a regular basis. This might be a common occurrence elsewhere in the world, but in Japan, this level of trust and friendship is nothing short of a miracle. It has been such a joy to be able to see God answer our prayers through others and to pass the baton, so to speak, to these new missionaries. Time doesn't allow for us to share about the many things God is doing among the Japanese people around us. If you're able, we encourage you to join us throughout the rest of this week as we can paint a fuller picture of ministry in Japan. As we close, we want to share about a conference I recently had the privilege of attending. The Japan Congress on Evangelism, which takes place every 7 years, held its 7th Congress in Nagoya, with over 1,200 mostly Japanese pastors and leaders in attendance. There, a cultural and spiritual shift took place that will likely reverberate for years to come. Remember we shared how the average pastor is over the age of 65? Well, the conference organizers wisely recognized that the future belongs to the next generation, and so they deliberately chose to have all the keynote speakers and panelists be younger than 50. It was a beautifully poignant passing of the baton. The Japanese church has also begun to wrestle with the idea of integral mission, the theme of this year's mission conference here at Park Street Church. They're starting to tear down the artificial divide between evangelistic and social responsibility. Some have established counseling ministries for the suicidal. Others are feeding poor children whose parents can only afford to give them 2 meals a day. These acts of compassion are essential in a society that does not see why Christianity, a foreign religion, has any relevance to them. Finally, this new generation of Japanese church leaders, through much prayer and discernment, issued a bold statement for a new era of evangelism in Japan. At the end of the Congress, they announced the goals for the next 7 years of evangelism in the form of a prayer that the church would begin collaborating across perspectives, denominations, regions, and cultures for the sake of gospel advancement across Japan. These are radically new concepts for a relatively homogeneous Japanese church steeped in tradition. As an observer from the outside, this seemed to me a sea change in the thinking of church leaders, a pivotal moment as the Japanese church must begin to confront many significant challenges. As the entire Congress prayed this prayer together to end our time, I was moved by this declaration of dependence on God to bring his people together in unity for the sake of his kingdom. Park Street Church, thank you for your tireless support and prayers, which are making a difference as the gospel transforms people and cultures across the world. It's a privilege to represent you in Japan. Arigatou gozaimasu. Now let's turn our hearts our minds to the Lord in prayer. Adopt a posture that is comfortable for you if it's sitting or kneeling, and let's turn our hearts to the Lord. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you that you are a God of mission. We thank you that you undertook that life-saving mission 2,000 years ago, send your son, Jesus, that he might call us to himself, rescue us out of our sin, and restore all things. God, we praise you that you have, through mission, touched each and one of our hearts. You've spoken to us in a language that we understand. God, you brought us in, we who have been outsiders, foreigners, and eunuchs. And God, we thank you that you have not forgotten the Japanese people or the Japanese church. Lord, would the distant islands proclaim your great name? And we pray that you would do that in Japan, that we would see revival, that we would see renewal, that we would see a new generation of Japanese believers rise up and worship you. God, we thank you for this invitation, the three invitations that Dr. Padilla DeBorst issued today to us out of your word. God, we thank you for this invitation that you've given us to return home to the true identity that we have in Christ, to be restored, not only us as people, but our creation, the creation around us as well. Lord, we thank you for this invitation that you've given us to right relationship, that we might invite those who are outside, those that we perhaps have built walls up to prevent from coming to you, that to invite them also to join us in worship. Thank you, Lord, that you invite us to go and be your peace to these people. And yet, Lord, we confess, we fail to see the eunuchs and the foreigners around us. Lord, we've made ourselves into first-class citizens, and we fail to see how we've created second- and third-class citizens. Lord, have mercy. Soften our hearts. Help us to see where we've been blind. Open our eyes to see how we might be living in exile even today. Lord, give us a thirst for you, a thirst that can be satisfied free of cost through the living waters offered through Christ. We will seek you, Lord, while you can be found. Thank you for that invitation. And we pray that you'd help us to go out in joy, to be led forth in peace as we also issue that invitation to others. And so, Lord, for this 2023 mission conference, we ask that you would press that invitation deeper into our hearts. Lord, as we explore the theme of integral mission, help us not to create false dichotomies. God, as we committed in our regional fellowships just now and later tonight, help us to practically live out our life on mission in the ways that we live out our daily lives. Lord, be in those evening sessions as we learn about church planting, tech and missions, home ministry, and Bible translation. God, we thank you that you are a creative God working in so many ways. Lord, be with us on Friday during our dinner together as we explore the questions of how do we serve you in an urban context, and as we learn more about how you're doing that in Japan. Lord, as we go out together on Saturday for the Serve City Go, Lord, would we find joy, be led forth in peace as we go together to serve this city. And bless our closing speaker as well, Dr. Michael Goheen, as he issues a final invitation to us to close our conference.
Lord, we ask that you would enable us to hear your continuous call to return to you and be healed, that you would go with us as conduits of your mercy towards those you have given us to serve. Father, we also ask you would bring us together in unity as the body of Christ, that you would make Park Street Church a place full of brothers and sisters known for our love for one another, that we would know what that looks like in this season. Lord, hear our prayer and give us hearts of understanding and compassion. We also pray for children around the world who are suffering from abuse and poverty, that you would have mercy on them and would provide them with caring parents. And we also lift up those suffering injury and loss because of the earthquake in Western Nepal. We pray for those who are suffering because of acts of war and violence, for healing from the mass shooting in Lewiston, Maine, for those affected by the conflicts in Israel and Gaza, Ukraine and Russia, and the military coups in Africa. Would you bring healing through the hands and feet of your church, peace through the powerful name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who alone brings reconciliation and hope. In Jesus' name, amen. Now let us continue our worship through the giving of our tithes and offerings.
Father, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news, who brought good news first to us, that we would repent and believe in you. Lord, send us out, Lord, as beautiful feet here to Boston, using these gifts of time, talent, and treasure. To the glory of your Son's name, we pray. Amen. The benediction, let me invite you to pick up one of the calendars as you leave the sanctuary today. Also to invite you downstairs to the Welcome Center to review and look at some of the stories of those on mission here in Boston and around the world. Also, we do have the invitation from the Park Street International Student Fellowship to join their regular meeting two floors down in the Fellowship Hall to hear more from Dr. Padilla de Borst, her testimony, and to enjoy a Persian meal together. Space is limited, so we invite you under those conditions. Now receive a benediction from someone who spent her life living on behalf of those on the outside, Mother Teresa. May the Lord today enable you to see Jesus in every person, in the sick, in the healthy, in the resident, in the immigrant, in all people. And though, Lord, you hide yourself often behind the unattractive, the irritable, the exacting, the unreasonable, may we still recognize you, Jesus, in your face, in each person. And may the God of our Lord Jesus Christ increase your faith, bless your efforts and your work now and forevermore, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.